that all of us are individually different. So whenever somebody asks me something like this, you know, that what do you feel about this category of people or that category of people, I do not have any standard answers. Talk marriage or talk parenting, there is no specific answer to, you know, what constitutes a good marriage, for example. People are still asking that question, particularly in India. Is a arranged marriage better or is a love marriage better? I find that question totally irrelevant. It has no meaning. In fact, jokingly somebody said, it's like asking, I want to commit suicide, is it better to hang myself or poison myself, which is a better way of committing. So the idea is, you want to marry, you want to lead a happy life. Whatever you want to do has to happen after the marriage. So there is no such thing as compatibility in a marriage. So you can't say that two people belonging to the same profession or same age or same caste or whatever it is, they will be more compatible. You know that we have marriages between people who are poles apart from each other and they are happy marriages. There are marriages where people have taken care to find out every possible compatibility factor, going right down to caste, subcaste, habits, age, culture, parenting, every possible thing they have worked out, and the marriage has not been harmonious or happy. So that's how it happens. The same thing with regard to parenting. Today in the 21st century, there is no such thing as, you know, what you should do. Every time when I'm doing a parenting workshop, people ask standardized questions like, you know, at what age should I give pocket money to my child? There is no answer. At what age should I give him a mobile phone, or at what age do I do this, or whatever, those type of things. There are absolutely no standardized answers to that. What we need to do is to look into the individual. Every individual is different. Okay, one general thing that I would like to talk about is that when a irreversible loss takes place, it could be either death of a loved one or it could be death of a relationship, a very close relationship like marriage. A lot of research went into this, and the person who really got exemplary on this is a doctor called Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. Kubler-Ross theory is Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross was a medical doctor who used to work primarily with old people. So a lot of her patients used to grow old and they used to die. So there were two things that she got concerned about. One was that when somebody is told that you are dying, you know, you have last stage of cancer or you have this or that and you are going to die, how do people respond to something like that? Because all of us live with the hope that we are sort of going to live indefinitely. That is not something that we contemplate or even discuss or something of that sort. Similarly, when the death actually takes place, how does a person cope with it? So what she did was that she came out with a sort of theory which talks about the grieving process of the loss. Her focus was on loss on death. And subsequently, she is also recognized as the mother of the hospice movement. You know what is that? Hospice? Hospice is not a hospital, but it is a place where people who are dying are taken care of. Where there cannot be a cure to give them care. That is the basic principle of a hospice. So let's say I develop cancer. I go to my doctor, he says, no, you have to go to the oncologist. I go there and then he says, no, you have to be admitted in a specialty hospital. Then they make me undergo surgery or chemotherapy or whatever it happens. I recover, I am fine, I am happy, I get back to normal life. But what happens in the case where the doctor says, oh, we have tried everything and everything has failed and now it's just a matter of time before you are going to pass away. So no hospital wants to keep me and there's no point in my remaining in the hospital also, because there's no treatment left. them. So they do, they take care of the people in two aspects. One is the medical or the physical aspect. So supposing I am unable to eat or drink, so what do I do? Can you just explain this a little further? So Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross came out with these steps of, bereavement or grief. So it starts with something like, shock or numbness. You go suddenly numb. If suddenly somebody comes and tells me that, your father who was fit and fine or whatever it is gone. Or even if you were suffering from cancer for the last 2 years, but today it has actually happened and he's gone. So there's this sense of numbness. There's this shock. And then there is denial. How can it be? I just met him this morning and I spoke to him. How can you tell me at 4 o'clock that he is no more? So there is this sense of, denial. There is a sense of sort of distress, Has life come to an end? Is there anything left for me about this thing? Then there could be steps like, anger. What did the doctors do? Why couldn't they have looked after? Or why couldn't my mother have looked after? Or something of that sort. Then there's a sense of blame. Who was responsible? Why did he die? Why couldn't this have been done? Why couldn't that have been done? And something of that sort. Then there's a stage called bargaining. God, please get my father back. I'm willing to do anything. This should not happen to me or something of that sort. There's a stage called shame. Did I let my father down? What, guilt? Did I not do anything sufficient for him? So that's how those steps go one by one. And the interesting thing that she said, this is what I want you to understand, that she said that the more you go through the grieving process, the better is the moving on. If you try to short circuit that grieving process, you do not move on. The wisdom of this, if you see, lies in our ancient traditions. Let's say a woman lost her husband. You know the ritual they would do. They would dress her up as a bride and then make her break her bangles, remove her Mangal Sutra, and everybody would come there and all that. And there would be these people, and there would be a 3rd day ceremony, a 13th day ceremony, a 30th day ceremony. Every time there would be wailing, crying, and all that used to go on. Today, when we look back upon it, we think that it is barbaric. But there is a wisdom behind it. It helped the person go through these stages. Every time that somebody came and they cried and they removed her Mangal Sutra ceremoniously, it was driving that point home. Now that those rituals are over, we have to find our own ways of going through it. What I have done is that I have modified process of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross to talk about death of a relationship. Sorry, it didn't strike me. I will get you, and when I go down, I'll just get you those steps. So when there is a death of a relationship, whether it is because of the death of the person or whether it is because of separation, breakdown of the relationship, whatever it is. But the point is that a relationship which I thought would be lifelong. All of us get into a relationship with the lifelong commitment, at least as Indians and all that. We are still groomed into that you marry only once, you make a commitment and it is for life. That's why we use the word life partner, that sort of thing. So initially, even in our wildest dreams, we have not thought that this is going to end up. So as and when that comes to an end, what is needed is to go through that process, the grieving process. Ask yourself whether you are stuck. For example, since you were asking me, Shubha, a simple thing like, am I still in denial? I come across people who still are in a state of denial. No, it can't be possible that this relationship will end. If, let's say, the legal process is not over, then I still have some hope saying, no, maybe it will get reversed. I also know people where the legal process is also over, but emotionally the closure has not taken place. One day he will learn a lesson and he will come back to me, that sort of thing. So that is what we call as denial. Same thing with guilt or blame or something. I come across lot of people who feel that, did I contribute to the downfall of this relationship? If somebody just says, no, don't be silly, it's not your fault. It's okay as a pacifying factor for that moment. But in the long run, that is not enough. Because if I'm actually feeling guilty, and somebody is telling me, no, it was not your fault, it's not that easy for me to accept it. So I have to go through that guilt as a step. Okay, what did I do to contribute? Yes, when he wanted to shift to Chennai and I said, no, I'm not leaving Bangalore and going. Was that one of the reasons why finally the relationship broke up? Fine, let me write it down and say, okay, this is how I may have contributed. But when you get a holistic picture, you know, there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 15 things that happened. Relationship don't break because of one odd incident or one odd unpleasantness or something. Out of that 15, if let's say two of them were my fault also, I can't really say that I am responsible for it. Right? If justice is demanded and only two out of the 15 were my contribution, then I can say same. So that's how I have to work through that guilt or that regret or whatever it may be. It could be that shame. Indian society is changing, thankfully, things are improving. But there is still an element of, you know, everybody is expected to be married lifelong and you're supposed to have, you know, partners, spouse, this, that. So when that is not there, what happens? You become automatically an outcast. You don't belong. At least now things are better. As you're aware, 10, 20 years back, no landlord would give a house on rent to a single lady, even if she is very respectable family, she's got a good job, she's got good income, she's got children. But the moment if she says that, no, I don't have a husband, landlord used to flatly refuse and say, we are not giving you the house on rent. And by chance, even if the landlord agreed, the landlady would cut it down because she is not confident about her husband. Somewhere along the line, she would feel very insecure that if this lady who doesn't have a man in her life, if she comes in, my husband, I don't know what, he will start chasing her or something. I don't want to have problems in my family life. So this is the other side of the picture of the so-called, you know, happy marriages and this and that. That is also there. That is what is happening. So anyway, that, as I told you, before you leave, I'll give you that slip. Keep it with you. What you need to do is either by yourself, if that is possible, or taking the help of a friend, a counselor, or whoever you trust. What you need to do is to, whether it has been 1 year or 10 years since that death of the relationship took place, or even if that relationship is still dying also, it doesn't matter. What you need to do is to ask yourself, how many of these have I gone through? And how many of these have I totally resolved? I gave you a simple example like denial. So I still have that 1% hope that no, things will may work out. If it is there, then I need to work on it within myself, not with the other person. He's got nothing to do with it. I need to work on it myself. I need to accept reality that no, this relationship is dead, whether the legal thing is over or not. That's the thing. Once that has been done, then I move on to the next, then I move on to the next. If there is some anger, let's say I had an arranged marriage and the marriage turned out to be a total fiasco. Okay, whatever had to happen has happened, I moved on. But do I have a lingering anger against my father? That he is a wise man, he is supposed to be knowledgeable. Why did he select such a person? Didn't he love his daughter? Didn't he care for me? Couldn't he have taken little more trouble when such an important decision had to place? So if I have that anger against my father, what happens is that if any one of these things are lingering, I am not in a position to give the best of life, to enjoy the best of life, to have the best of relationships and things like that. I need a marital partner. But as I give an example now, that if my father had selected my partner for me, and I had just had full faith in my father and I had agreed to that alliance, and then everything went downhill. It is a closed chapter, the legal process is over, I have moved on in life, I I settle down. But my relationship with my father still remains. He is still my father as long as he is alive and I am alive. He is my father. Now, if I am carrying some sort of a blame or anger against him, what happens is that it prevents me from leading a normal life. Now, our whole idea and focus of a gathering like this is to ensure our quality of life. We are not sitting here as, you know, mediators or marriage counselors or whatever it is. We are sitting here to see what I can do. Whatever has happened to me so far has happened, good, bad, ugly, whatever it is. But from today onwards, what do I do to improve my quality of life? Which should include my near and dear. Only one person has gone away from my life. My father may still be there, my mother may be there, my sister may be there, my child may be there. Now this is the time to work on strengthening those relationships, because they are the important anchors in our life. But we cannot do it if we are carrying the baggage. Just to give you an example, that, you know, a lady who has had a bad time with her husband and has finally separated out. Now she is bringing up a girl child. Without her realizing, she may become extremely possessive about her daughter. She may feel that any boy or any man coming close to my daughter is a threat, because of personal experience. If that personal experience has been resolved, then she can look at her child neutrally. And if she does that, if she becomes possessive about her daughter and tries to segregate her, what happens to a child of 21st century? You have a 5-year, 10-year, 15-year-old daughter whose mother is constantly pulling her back. She starts rebelling. And the relationship between mother and daughter gets fine. You don't even realize why it has happened. Because there is, what do you call it, that self-righteous thought that, you know, I'm doing it for your good. And the girl is good enough or intelligent enough and has had sufficient exposure to say, all my friends have loving mothers, they don't behave like this, why are you behaving like this? This is not for my good, I don't agree with you. So you see, at a time when you actually needed that relationship with your child, which should have become stronger and an anchor, on the other hand, you are losing out on that. These are the things that we need to go through when we are working on this factor of the grieving process, and then comes the rehabilitation thing. So that is a basic answer to Shobha's question. What would you like to proceed further? There is always this element that, you know, the absentee parent is always that Santa Claus type of thing. So, if I am living with my mother, however much she is struggling, whatever she is doing, this thing is there that if my father had been there, I would have had a better quality of life. And whether you like it or not, or whether you admit it or not, children of this generation do have some amount of that self-centeredness. You know, they are not that sacrificing people like how you people are, or your parents were, or whatever it is. Somewhere we are actually programming our children to focus on their own self. So when the child is self-focused, the child is looking for answers as to how I could have had a better life. I could have had a better life if my father was here. No, what was my father? My father is an engineer or this or manager or executive or businessman or whatever he is. He would have been earning so much money and that would have been there for me. I am being deprived of that because of whatever has happened. Now, to answer that question, again I come back to the same thing. It depends on how comfortable you are with yourself. Somewhere along that line, children observe, they when you say that I should have come. Then I say that you should have stayed with father or whatever it is. If I have answered the questions to myself long back, it makes it easier for me to answer to my child. Otherwise, what happens is I become very defensive. If I start saying things to this child, like, you know, you don't know what I went through. You know that he was violent. You know that he was putting No, I think you're bluffing or you're exaggerating. I don't believe you. That's what But if I am not defensive, and if I say, okay, in this particular case, for example, you are 22 years old, you are already an adult. Or even if it's a 15-year-old child, you can still do it and say, okay, now let's sit down and discuss it. Everybody makes the same. Maybe, as you said, I may have been. But let's review it. Even now, it's not too late to sit and review and resolve what happened. If you were in my position, what would you have done if you were facing these issues? And then you see how the child turns around. These are some of the things. So, good parenting also depends on what I come back to, that is, how much you are at peace with yourself. How much you have resolved whatever you have gone through in life, which, as I said, was totally unexpected. So, whenever you go through this sort of a situation, you need to work on that. See, when you said something very significant, that he is there with us, in spirit or whatever it is, you know, you may even be talking to him, or you may be thinking that, oh, he would have liked this yellow colored t-shirt, you know, those sort of things, that the person becomes so much part of your life that just because death has taken place, you can't just, you know, wipe him off from the slate, which is good, because it gives you that warmth and that, you know, feeling that you are not alone or something of that sort. But it also leads to what I was telling you about the grieving process, the denial. That physically he is not here. Let's take a different situation. If he was alive, but he had got a very good project in America, some place else, and he had to go there for a year, and you knew that that 1 year will get you so much of, you know, income or progress or something, the family will be able to live happily. But you cannot uproot your children and take them for a year or whatever. So now what would happen in that 1 year that he is away? There is a school program. And if somebody asks you, ask your daughter where is your father, or asks you where is your husband, what would you say? You would say he's gone to NL. Why do you say that? Because there is no denial. You discussed it with him. Either you willingly said, okay, go, you'll be able to earn money and, you know, we'll be able to have a better life. Or even if you didn't like it, you said, no, he likes it, it's going to be a big boost to his career or something, so he wants it. Let me not stop him. So I had allowed and I had accepted it. This acceptance is what comes in the way. So to be able to say that he is no longer with us, he has passed away or something like that. With a small child, you can use a slightly different terminology by saying that he is in heaven. Something of that sort. He is looking after us from heaven. He has not come to this program, but he is watching us from there. Let the child have that feeling that my daddy is there, he loves me, he cares for me. But at the same time, not in that denial that tomorrow he will come physically here. He is never going to come back. So somewhere you need to sit and talk it over with them. Talk in terms of past tense. This is again general for all of you. Then even when you are talking something good or describing something, any of your cases, if the child says that you remember we had gone to Ooty for a holiday, it was so nice, all of us had gone and all that. So you say, yes, at that time daddy was with us and we did enjoy, we went for that holiday and now it is past. So there are a lot of experiences of life which are good memories, let us retain that memory. So when you sit down and talk about the good things, where all of you had gone for a picnic, or where there was some broccoli cheese today, or something or the other about it. And then talk about the fact that it is past tense. And we need to move on in life, that sort of thing. But if you do it systematically, nothing will happen immediately, but over a period of time, they will be able to deal with it. And then if she says something like, I don't want to go to the school because other this thing, you say, if you don't go, you are letting down daddy. Daddy loves you. Daddy is sitting in heaven and he'll be watching. He also knows that you have a school function and he'll be watching you over there. How will daddy feel that just because I am sitting there, you refuse to go to school and he'll be looking around for you, he will not find you over there. So we have to make daddy proud. Come on, let's go. Sometimes it is even better to go and say that, see, my husband is no more. These are my children, I am so and so, this is what I do or something, before people ask. Because remember that when you have this sort of single status, regardless of what the cause has been, anything which doesn't fit into regular society, everybody is uncomfortable to ask. So nobody actually wants to ask you that question, and yet, number one, the curiosity is there, and number two, that discomfort is there. Now what do I talk to you? So, if I know that or somebody has just vaguely told me that you lost your husband, I don't even feel like talking to you because I say, what will I talk to her? My God, she must be mourning. I don't know, she must be there. But the moment when you introduce yourself and say that, you know, my husband was this, and he passed away at this time. I have a son, I have a daughter, and this and that. Now you made me confidence. This is part of what I was telling you about rebuilding your other relationships. Whether it's in your office where you work, whether it's in your neighborhood, sometimes when you shift and go to a new locality, everybody is wondering how come there is no man here over here, what could have happened. They're all, you know, that gossip type of thing. So if you could just plain and simple, how you introduce yourself over here, if you can just say, go to your neighbor and say, good evening, I've just moved into this flat. I am a single mother, I have this child or two children or whatever it is. I work in such organization, this is what I do. Earlier I was living in so and so place. I thought this is closer to my child's school, so we shifted over here. The moment you start talking about it as a natural process, you know, people get comfortable to go. So there is another factor which I wanted to tell you from my side. As I told you, whenever somebody is different, they are automatically looked upon as aliens. You know, so we can see, for example, our citizens from the northeast states. If anybody from Manipur or that thing comes over here, they are immediately looked upon as aliens. And we are very suspicious, we don't include them. Of late, you must have been seeing the amount of hatred against Negroes who are here in a lot of them coming here to study and, you know, the blacks, and they are facing that. So whenever you are different from the majority, you are always, you know, kept a distance apart. So accept that. Don't fight that. Don't say that, you know, why should somebody treat me differently just because I am not whatever it is. Accept it. So how cope with it. You find what we say, you know, that birds of a feather flock together, that sort of thing. So you find like-minded people who have similar situations, similar interests or something of that sort. So if you are a person from Manipur and you speak Manipuri language, in the entire locality you may not get a single person who speaks. So what do? You go hunting. And even if somebody is in Jainagar who speaks Manipuri, I make friends with that person, and then if I can't go there also, I can talk to him on the phone and get that thing that, okay, I can converse in my mother tongue to somebody right here in this city. That is where the significance of such a group or whatever comes around. Whenever you find that you can, and here again it works two ways. One is on a one-to-one basis. So I identify one person who is in a similar boat or in a similar situation, and I link up with that person. The other is to do it as a group, because then it starts binding. With one person may or may not have the same attitudes and behavior and thinking as you have. So it becomes difficult if you are relying only on a one-to-one basis. But when there is a group, if A is not available, B is busy, C is not interested in me, I can find D and say, okay, we can share something and we can understand each other and things of that sort. I wanted to share with you about, you must have heard of this organization called AA, Alcoholics Anonymous. It is Alcoholics Anonymous, AA. This is the most successful self-help group in the whole world. They exist in about 130 countries. It started off in the year 1937. It was very interesting. There was a gentleman who used to every evening go from office straight to the bar, get drunk. And then he would quarrel with his wife, he would have all sorts of problems. He wanted to get out of that drinking habit, but he was just not being able. He had got so badly addicted that the moment evening comes, even if he forces himself to go home, half an hour later he would come out and again go to the bar. He had a friend who was a doctor. So he went to him and said that, you are a doctor, can you not cure me? Can you not do something so that I don't have this craving for alcohol? Interestingly, the doctor said, if I had a cure, I would have cured myself. I am also an alcoholic. And I am very upset about it, and I don't know what to do. So what I can do is, I finish my work, you finish your work, come to this park which is in the middle of our this thing. We'll sit here and prevent each other from going to the bar. So beyond a certain point, the bars will start closing, you'll start getting hungry, you'll have going to have, go home and have dinner. So that crucial time will pass off, and then we'll both go home. That's how Alcoholics Anonymous started off. And today, as I said, it is in 135 countries. I've had the privilege. There's only one person in AA who is called the A-class trustee, who is a non-alcoholic. Because they need a name and a face. Alcoholics are anonymous, as we say. So they don't come out in the open and they don't declare for that sort of thing. So they need one person. So I had the privilege of being their A-class trustee. And I worked very close with them. To become a member of AA, all you have to do is to walk in. If this is an AA meeting going on, I have to walk in and introduce myself only by my first name, saying, my name is Ali and I am an alcoholic. I've admitted that I'm an alcoholic. That's all I have to do. If I say, I'm a social drinker, I can give up whenever I want. Once in a while, I drink out. You first admit that you're an alcoholic, then you become a member. Beyond that, you don't want to give any details. You can remain anonymous. You can even give a pseudonym. Instead of saying Ali, I will say, my name is Vijay. Okay, we'll call you Vijay. No issues. That sort of thing. And when they meet, what happens is that everybody talks about how alcohol has spoiled their life. So one person says that, my name is Ali, I'm an alcoholic, and I'm getting very upset because my wife is threatening to leave me and go away. I'm having financial problems and this and that. But today I've not had a drink. Instead of going and having a drink, I've come here for this meeting, so I'm hoping that today I will not have a drink. The the next person sitting says, my name is Vijay and I'm an alcoholic and I've not had a drink today. So I turn to him and say, when do you normally go for drink? He said, the last time I had alcohol was in the year 2004. 13 years you've not had a drink. Yes, I've not had a drink. Then you said that today I've not had a drink. Yes, I live one day at a time. Because I don't know whether tomorrow I will end up in the bar. So I'm coming, still coming here because I want to reassure to myself. So when I hear stories from people, I get reassured to me that, you know, I need to keep away from that. And then the best part of it, which I wanted to suggest to you people, is they have what is known as a 12-step process for rehabilitation and getting back to normal life. That 12th step is supposed to be the most critical, which says, I will reach out to a brother alcoholic and give all my support to that person in whatever way I can. There are the AA members who go to another alcoholic's office and stand outside waiting for him to come out. When he comes out, they say, don't go to the bar, come with me, we'll go and sit in coffee day or we'll do something else. That is what keeps the thing going. So they don't come there expecting, when I go there, I will get some benefits. They will help me or something. I am coming here to help the others. And that can keep the thing going. I have also had seen, I've been part of and I've helped to promote a number of self-help groups. Those which fizzled off were because a person comes there and says, okay, every week or every month you are having a meeting. I have attended 6 meetings, how have I benefited from that? So what's the point? Why should I waste my time? If you come with that attitude, nothing will happen. But if I say, I have been through misery, so I know I can empathize with this person or this person or this person, I have felt that pain. The other people who have not gone through a similar experience, they can't feel the pain that I can feel. So I am here, I can't help her in any way. She lives in the other end of the city, she's got her own issues, she's got her family, children, this, that. I have nothing to do with her. But I am sitting here in this meeting to show my solidarity that you are not alone. So I will come here, I will sit. I may not even open my mouth, I will allow everybody to talk and I will go away. So this is my contribution to people whom I empathize with, not sympathize. Remember the critical difference. There will be a lot of people who sympathize with you. Actually, like we said, we don't want pity from the people. Your father died, is it, and all that. Obviously, the child is going to be very upset. She doesn't want. But empathy is something that, you know, we need. And empathy can be given only by a like-minded group like this, who says that, yes, I understand what you're doing. Even if your circumstances are totally different from mine, I can still say that I am one person who can empathize with you. In this generation. One is the single child phenomenon. One generation back, nobody had even heard of a concept of one child or two child or whatever it is. Just to drive the point home, can any one of you tell me how many siblings were either your father or your mother? Like my father had 3 brothers and 2 sisters. So including him, there were 6 of them. Anyone tell me about your father or your mother number?
Nine.
Now, how many of you sitting over here have 9 children? 7 children? 5 children? 3 children? So you know it is either 1 or 2. So within one generation, from your parents to your children, we have moved from a huge family to the one or two. At least if there are two, there is some semblance of understanding, you know, what do they say. But a single child has needs which are totally different, even if it's a child with two parents. So let's first start with that. That the single child's needs are different from a child. I'm not saying there's anything wrong. You choose to have one child, it's perfectly okay, that's your wish. But the needs of a single child are different from a child who has siblings. That is what I want you to understand. In fact, that I managed to successfully complete. I do have a small handbook for the single child. You can pick up a copy if you want. In that, I have mentioned what are the specific areas where a single child may require some different inputs, which child. Just to give you a very quick, emoting, expressing emotions. A child can express emotions much easier to their own peer level. I am angry with you. I hate you. You don't come near me. You are this. You are that. And then 5 minutes later, okay, I'm still angry with you. I'm not talking to you, but come and play with me. I don't want to play alone. Something of that sort happens. So they learn how to emote. Similarly, they learn how to share. They know that anything that comes into the house, and my brother or sister is going to grab it. So I have to start learning how to defend, when to give, when not to give. If I become too greedy, then I get one back from daddy who comes and says, no, you have to share with your sister or something of that sort. The single child starts presuming that everything is mine. So when you have that single child, that itself is there. On top of that, if there is a single child of a single parent, then it becomes doubly. Because, now put yourself in the shoes of the child. I don't have a brother or sister as a single child in this household. Even if they are grandparents and extended family and all that, today's children are not connecting, unfortunately, to their grandparents as they used to. Because somewhere along the line, I told you, that self-centeredness has become so much that they are thinking of grandchildren and grandparents as some outsiders or visitors or some. Okay, you have told me I have to pay respect to Tata, I have to be polite to him, or I have to listen to Adi, I will do that. But I don't identify myself with him as I do with my father or mother. So if one is out and I have only one person, so all my expectation goes on that one parent. So at this young age, you have to start off by telling your child that certain things you will get, certain things. This I can do, that I cannot do. A little bit of a tantrum, ignore totally. See, that's one mistake which we make as a parent very often. If my child is throwing a tantrum and I have decided no, my child is saying I want ice cream. I feel no, this is not the right time to buy ice cream. Tomorrow is Sunday, anyway we are going to the mall and anyway she will ask for an ice cream, so I am going to buy it. So today I don't want to buy her ice cream. I have logically decided that I don't want to buy her ice cream. So she asked for it and I said no. She asked second time, I say no. She is pleading, whining, I say no. She starts throwing a tantrum. She starts making a scene. And I get fed up and I said, take your stupid ice cream and go. That is the worst thing that you can do to her. If you have decided that I am not going to give the ice cream, let her start banging her head against the wall. When it starts paining, she will stop. Person. Let her refuse to eat food. You are not buying me ice cream, I am not going to have food. Okay, you are going to be empty. What I will do is, I will keep this food here on the table. Even in the middle of the night, you get hungry, you get up and come and have it. But don't panic. Oh my God, she will starve. No child starves herself to death. Let me tell you. That nothing is going to happen. The more, and if you do that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 times, she understands and says, mommy will not get carried away by all these type of things. So, the little bit of that carrot and stick, some places, and where you have a doubt, maybe I should give her the ice cream, because after all, she loves the ice cream, and the weather is become warm or something of that sort. Then you give a maybe answer. Let me see what time then I can get back from office, or if I can complete that opening and we still have time, or this. Or Ajiva supposed to come, if she doesn't come or something of that sort, then I will do it. Remind me after an hour or something like that. Keep the options open. Decide after an hour whether you want to do it or not. And if you feel that yes, it's okay for me to buy it. You say normally I would not have bought it, because anyway Sundays you go to the mall and you have your favorite ice cream and all that. But today, since you asked for it, I also want you to understand that you cannot demand it every Saturday. Today, because you were so keen, you wanted it, and I didn't want to say no to you, I've given it to you, but that does not mean that every Saturday you're going to get it. So next Saturday, right now I'm telling you, I will take you for that ice cream, provided next Saturday you don't buck it. Are you okay with it? What happens next Saturday, tell me? And mothers?
They will go
again. Again, she will say, no, I want it. Next Saturday, don't buy, mommy, but this Saturday you have to buy. This Saturday, this happened, that happened, that happened. Don't be very rigid. I had told you, somewhere I think the message has not got very clear, and since you are saying so much, no. Okay. But next Saturday, maybe what you do is take a piece of paper. If she is old enough, you make her write, otherwise you write on a piece of paper and say, next Saturday, look at the calendar, what is going to be the date on next Saturday, it's going to be 11th of March. 11th March, Saturday, no ice cream for whatever her name is. Pin it up. So now you have let go by another week. The next Saturday, you put your foot down. Today, you are not going to get ice cream. There again, you can be a little liberal by saying, if you want a chocolate, I'll get it. We'll go for a walk, we'll go down to that river, have to anyway buy something. A small chocolate, if you want that. And the moment she says, I don't want that stupid chocolate, I want only ice cream. Now, chocolate is also out. Because you said stupid, no? The chocolate got very angry with the you called it stupid. So now, chocolate is not going to come to simple things, we all know it. But the question is that, you know, when we are emotional, when we are sentimental, how much do we put it into practice on a consistent basis? Very important. Let your child go on and on and on talking. Never stop your child, and particularly when it's something to do with emotions. You are the worst mama in the whole world. I hate you. You are the worst mama in the whole world. There was this little fellow who told his mother, you were taking me to the school, but you take me up to whatever, you know, 10 yards away from the school, from that corner, and you go away. Don't come up to the gate. Why? You are the fattest mama in my class. Don't come, because you don't know. Now, these are ways and means in which the child is finding this footing. You know, the child is communicating with you, the child is bringing out certain emotions. As I said, if it is safe for him to walk those extra 20 steps, you say, okay, but I will stand here and wait till you go inside the gate or whatever it is. Do it. Oblige, doesn't matter. But do make it a point the next weekend, sit with him and say, why do you feel bad if mama comes over there? Why do you hate mama? You said you hate mama. I accepted it. Yes, you must be having it. Now I want to know what are the reasons that you didn't buy me ice cream. Also, that is why. So you mean to say, if I buy you ice cream, I'll become the best mama in the whole world? Does it work that way? It doesn't work that way. And why do you think, come on, now you tell me, why do you think mama didn't buy you that ice cream? Did I say that I hate you? I always say that I love you. But still I don't buy ice cream. Why is it that we do that? Make her understand her emotions.
What if they compare it to the other parent?
Yes, that is very common. They will do that, and particularly an absentee parent. Because the father she is seeing only once in a week. So the father is showing his best side to the child. The father doesn't have to take care of her or make her do homework or whatever, all that tolerate her tantrums and all that. So she is going to say that, see, daddy is so good, you are so bad. Accept it. Yes. I'm glad you feel daddy is good because he's your daddy. No? I'm glad you have a good daddy. But I'm still not going to buy you your ice cream. I do love you, I care for you, and I'm still going to make you sit and do the homework. I love you very much, but I'm going to sit here and see that you completely I'll go and live with daddy, he won't force me to do homework. That we'll see as and when that happens. We'll, see. Right now we are not living with daddy, no? You meet daddy only on Sundays. Right now, weekdays we have to do homework, and then see to it that you do your homework. And then, most importantly, as I told you, that time it was a conflict situation to handle it then. When there is no conflict situation, when you are on a weekend, when you are on off, and nothing is, no homework, or holidays have started, that's the time when you sit and say, I remember you were telling me that you hate me because I make you do homework. You don't like me because of that. You are even telling me that daddy never forces me to do homework. Why are you doing that? So let me explain to you. Are you willing to listen to me? Why homework is important? Why studies is important? I love you so much that I want to ensure that you study well and you get good this thing so that you can go ahead and do that. Many a time children give a deaf ear to it. Mama, I don't believe you. No, no, no. Don't get taken away by that. It is sinking into their mind. They will not acknowledge like adults and say, thank you very much for enlightening me. I never knew this or something. And because they are uncomfortable and the truth is coming, which they know is the truth, they will actually protest by saying, ah, you are always lecturing me. No, I still feel that is very good. The message is over. See, this is a very delicate thing. I know that you are the one who is facing this challenge, so it's easy for me to sit and give you a lecture over here. Nonetheless, I would like to tell you that this is what I meant by saying denial. If I want to live in a state of denial, if I know whatever your age is today, 30, 25, 45, whatever your age is today, you say, I've got my life ahead of me. A certain thing has happened, which is different from what happens to other families in my neighborhood. They are father, mother bringing up the child. I am only mother bringing up my child, so I am different from the others. First thing, as you yourself said, there are these children who will try to bring it out from the child. There are these, there are even these mothers of the children who will be there in the play area and who will ask, in which city in US is your father? Obviously the child doesn't know. Which month did...
Do you think some special kind of counseling should be taken in regard to like how to cope with being a single parent or how to do that?
Yeah, that's what I was telling you. Know that today I'll give you that this thing. I want you to have a look at the grieving process on the loss of a relationship. At the first level, do it by yourself. Do an introspection and tick out. This I know, I am not in denial. Anybody ask me, I say that yes, I am a single parent, my husband is no more, or whatever this is, and this is what. So I can put it on. As far as this blame is concerned or anger, I still carry an anger against my father or something. So put a red mark over there. Then ask yourself, what can I do to work on these issues? Like if I say that, no, how long can I go on doing this? And please remember, it leads to more gossip than you deny. Ah, see, she's saying that. That means something must have been said, that is. If she can look, any one of you can look in the eye and say, I am separated or I am divorced from my husband. I am bringing up my child, this is my child, and I am happy with. Very soon, that thrill of the gossip goes away. What do they gossip? and she herself is admitting the. They can't tease you, they can't do anything. And the same thing, you empower your child. Yes, my daddy does not live with other. Child need not use the word separation divorce. My daddy does not live with me. He lives separately. I live with my mama. And if she has a brother or sister or even a grandmother or grandfather, my family is my mama, my grandmother, my brother. We live together. Daddy does not live with us. Or in your case, daddy comes every Sunday to see me. But other than that, he does not live with me. That helps. Okay. So going back to this this thing, the grieving process. Once you start doing that, see how much you can do on your own. Like, can you now slowly switch over and say, okay, now I'm going to be a little assertive. With confidence, I'm going to look a person in the eye and say, this is this or not. I will let you do. If you find that, no, somewhere, you know, I don't have that confidence level, I'm not able to do it. Then what you said, you know, look for a counselor. And counselor does not have to be a professional counselor. You have an elder sister who is a very mature and a balanced person, and she's got the time for you. Let her sit and help you out. Okay, next time you have to talk to that neighbor, I'll come with you and I'll say that, tell them. And then she'll give you a feedback. No, when you were telling, you know, you almost sounded like an apology as though you have done something wrong. So now you reverse. Come on. Say it.
I'm coming to that.
If that is that. So first is what you do for yourself. Second is what you can do with your near and dear, whoever is supportive. If that is not there, then definitely you are welcome to come back for a one-to-one discussion. I am there. We have a team, so others are there. Whoever you are comfortable with, one of us can help you through that process. At the same time, one more thing that you can do is, now that this initiative has been taken and things of that sort, if you can have regular, you know, interactions, that's going to be something very useful. And don't come into that meeting like this asking yourself, how do I benefit? You are not coming here to benefit. You are not coming here for looking for some benefit. Did I get something out of this meeting? Did X, Y, Z help me? No. I'm coming here just to show solidarity with a group. See, if you have, say you belong to a particular community or a particular extended family or whatever, and there is a ritual, like a puja or a ceremony or something happening, do you go there expecting, what do I get out of it? You say, I am part of this extended family. I owe it to them that I have to go over there. Or even if I don't like, my mother wants to go, so for her sake, I will go and live. There are times when it is unpleasant also, people gossip, people don't talk properly, but I still keep going back home because there is a sense of belonging. If you can treat this as a family and say, this is my family or my community or whatever it is, I would like to be part of this thing. And you will see the difference that when you are facing, like how you said, when you are facing this situation where, you know, either externally where somebody is trying to point out or gossip about you, or internally, like my child is asking me this question, or like how you said that, you know, mama, I don't feel like going to school because they keep asking where is your daddy or something of that sort. You know that you are not alone. That is why I gave you that example of AA, to say that I am not alone. There are people who are doing it, so I can also do it. These are the three things that I want you to keep in mind. And it will be wonderful if you can even spend the time today before you disperse in getting to know each other, understanding each other at a human level. It's not important whether she's a doctor or she's an HR person or she's a whatever it is. From the human angle, if you could, you know, do a round of 4-5 introductions, like, you know, what type of music you like, or what are your extracurricular activities, or what do you love most about your child. Each of these things gives you an insight into that person as an individual. Don't label people that, you know, she is a widow because she has lost her husband, she is a divorcee because she has been divorced. We are basically all human beings, but with a common cause, with that thing of that we want to be there for each other. So you start that process, I will give you those that giving process.